So good morning, everyone. My name is Paul Flanagan. I am the Director of Corporate Communications here at CPS Energy. And I want to welcome everyone here to the beautiful Our Lady of the Lake University campus. Today is a really exciting day for us as we take the next step in the evolution of our new energy economy initiative. In just a couple hours, we'll unveil our future plans to transform the former Mission Road power plant into what we're calling the Energy Partnerships Innovation Center, or Epicenter. But I'd like to welcome some of our esteemed guests who are going to be with us today, actually. We are many of you know that we are in District 5, and that is Councilwoman Shirley Gonzales' district, and she will be here momentarily for the big unveiling, and so she'll definitely be here. Also, we have members of our CPS Energy Citizens Advisory Committee, and I wanted to recognize them as well. Also, we have members of our founding partners, our New Energy Economy founding partners. I wanted to recognize S.H. Yoon, who is President and CEO of OCI Solar Power. We have Gina Gardner from Landis & Gear, and she's the West Regional Manager. And we have Raj Viswani with us as well from Silver Spring Networks, and he's their Chief Technology Officer. And I wanted to welcome everyone, senior leadership at CPS Energy. Welcome to our event today. I want to get into a few housekeeping notes as well. Coffee and refreshments will be available in the back of the room throughout the morning. After this panel, we'll take a short break, and then we'll come back for the second panel and the unveiling. Please enjoy the refreshments. The restrooms are outside by the stairs where you entered, and there's additional restrooms to the right down the hall. Okay, let's get on with our presentation. I don't think it's any surprise that Texas is at the epicenter, and pun is intended there, of clean energy generation and consumption. We have with us today a panel of industry leaders who will showcase the role our state is playing in energy innovation, innovation that will have an impact for generations to come. We are very fortunate to have with us today Evan Smith, Editor-in-Chief, CEO, and co-founder of the Texas Tribune, as our moderator for this first panel. The Texas Tribune is a nonprofit, nonpartisan digital news organization that was recently called one of the nonprofit news sector's runaway success stories. The Tribune's deep coverage of Texas politics and public policy can be found at its website at texastribune.org. Evan spent, previous to the Texas Tribune, Evan spent nearly 18 years at Texas Monthly, including 8 years as editor and a year as president and editor-in-chief. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Evan Smith and our first panel.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to see all of you. Appreciate the invitation to be here, and of course appreciate especially the opportunity to be with our distinguished panelists. Let me introduce them, and I'll tell you how we're going to do this conversation. It's actually going to be part presentation, part conversation. It'll be an opportunity for people in the audience to ask questions toward the back end of this as well. I'm pleased to be joined first by Lynn Abramson, who is a Senior Associate for Clean Energy at the Pew Charitable Trust. She joined Pew's Clean Energy Initiative in June 2013. She coordinates the Clean Energy Business Network, a group of business leaders working in all sectors of clean energy, manages research projects, educational opportunities, and advocacy tools to inform and engage individuals in policy issues affecting the industry. She has a bachelor's degree in biology from Boston University and a doctoral degree in marine and atmospheric sciences from Stony Brook University. On her left is Chris Eugster, who is Group Executive Vice President and Chief Generation and Strategy Officer. Well, no, actually, Andrew is in the middle. Well, I've already screwed this up. Well, I wanted to do it alphabetically, so I'm just going to go with the way I intended to do it. All the way on my left is Chris Eugster, who is Group Executive Vice President, Chief Generation and Strategy Officer for CPS Energy, responsible for overall operations, dispatch, and evolution of CPS Energy's generation capabilities, including 6,500 megawatts of traditional power plants and a 1,100 megawatts of renewables. Also responsible for corporate strategy, including integration of new technologies and development of new products and services. In the middle, and it's appropriate that he be in the middle because he may fall over from exhaustion, having traveled as far as he has, so he can hit either Chris or Lynn on either side, is Andrew Oh, who is Vice President for Global Solar at OCI. In his current role, he leads global solar power development here in the U.S., as well as China, South Africa, North Africa, and India. He also leads new business development in the energy storage field, as well as working on the difficult task of structuring finance for global solar assets. He received his undergraduate degree in electrical engineering from Korea University and his MBA in 2006 from Duke University. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. So we're going to talk about the great topic of Texas and its role in the day's subject, and we've asked each of our panelists to prepare about 5 minutes of presentation. I gather that both Lynn and Chris have presentations that will be up on screen. Andrew tells me that he'll be just talking to us for about 5 minutes. Is that
yes,
right?
Yes.
So let me ask Lynn to move over to the podium first, and she'll do her presentation. Then we'll have Chris second. We'll finish with Andrew. Then we'll visit up here for a little while, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. So Lynn, take it away.
Great. Well, thank you so much for having, is this working? Okay, perfect. Well, thank you so much for inviting me to participate today. I really appreciate the invitation from CPS Energy. I'm really honored to be here on such a distinguished panel, and I'm very excited to learn more about what the Epicenter's plans are. As I'm going to talk about, we've seen in our research that Texas really has emerged as a leader in the clean energy economy. And I feel like it's very impressive that CPS Energy is taking this step in partnership with all of these great partners here in the room today to really try to accelerate the local clean energy economy here and make this a center for innovation. So I'm here to discuss some research that the Pew's Charitable Trust completed last fall. As Evan mentioned, I'm Lynn Abramson, and I work for our Clean Energy Initiative, which works to promote clean energy for its economic, national security, and environmental benefits. And we do this through a combination of research and public policy advocacy. And beginning last fall, in the fall of 2014, and concluding this January, we released a series of 8 research reports looking at states with emerging clean energy economies. And we selected those states, which included Texas, because we saw that there was some leadership in their policies, the amount of private investment they were attracting, or other metrics that made them interesting case studies. And in some cases, these are states that are at a crossroads where they could either continue to emerge as leaders or might actually take a downward decline. And what we found very interesting about Texas is that it is obviously known as a leader in the oil and gas industry, but it really is a leader in the clean energy economy as well, in renewables and in industrial energy efficiency. And to give you a sense of what we found this means for the state's economy, we looked at the amount of private investment that development projects such as solar projects, wind projects, biomass, efficiency projects have attracted to the state. And we found that over the 5-year period that we examined, which was 2009 through 2013, there were 5.6 gigawatts of new clean energy projects added. And that attracted about $10.6 billion in private investment. Looking forward, our projections are that over the next decade, we're going to see about $42 billion of private investment in this field. Again, that's just from the development projects alone. Doesn't even include some of the, you know, ancillary benefits such as investments in new technologies, mergers and acquisitions, things like that. So this is a very impressive figure, and it is actually the highest of the 8 states that we chose to examine. And our research examined 3 sectors where we saw there was particular promise for Texas' clean energy economy. So first, the wind sector. The state has the highest installed capacity of wind power in the nation at 12.8 gigawatts, and it generates about 1/4 of the nation's wind electricity. It also ranks first in the nation for industrial energy efficiency technologies, which include cogeneration, so when you generate heat and power simultaneously, and it roughly doubles the efficiency compared to traditional power generation, as well as waste heat to power, which is the recovery of waste heat from industrial processes to generate electricity. So that can be used on natural gas pipelines and manufacturing facilities. And because of the state's large industrial energy use, it ranks first in the nation with 17 gigawatts of capacity in those technologies. And Texas also has the greatest solar potential in the nation and has only recently started harnessing this resource. So we see that as a growth opportunity. So in the year we picked to examine it, in 2013, it ranked 13th nationwide in solar capacity at 213 megawatts. And we do project that to increase in coming years. And what's one thing that's interesting for San Antonio in the solar sector is that the cities of San Antonio and Austin combined have about 85% of the state's solar capacity. And partly that is due to the demand here, but it's also partly due to progressive policies. So CPS Energy, for example, has a goal of installing 20% capacity from clean energy by 2020. The city of Austin has a 25% goal. Those goals really do make a difference in driving investment in these sectors. And as I mentioned, one of the drivers of Texas's clean energy economy is simply its enormous resource potential. It has the highest wind and solar resource in the nation. I mentioned the large industrial energy use that creates opportunities for that sector. But we have found that also policy makes an important difference as well in setting the stage to really harness those resources. And so, as many of you know, Texas has a renewable portfolio standard that required the installation of 10 gigawatts of clean energy by 2025, a goal that was surpassed 15 years ahead of schedule. The state also has an energy efficiency resource standard that requires 30% of annual growth in electricity to come from energy savings. And then we also found that the competitive electricity market in the state, the right to distributed generation, the right to sell power for a non-utility to sell power directly to consumers, some of those competitive aspects of the state's market have also encouraged the growth of the clean energy industry. If consumers want it, they can put solar panels on their house. If they want to purchase solar or wind or industrial efficiency directly from someone else, they have the option to do so. So that's actually been an important factor as well. Federal policy has also played an important role. So the federal tax credits, such as the production tax credit for wind, the investment tax credit for solar, and as well as coupled with state investments, have really made a difference as well in financing some of these clean energy projects and bringing the cost down so that they're becoming increasingly cost competitive throughout the state with conventional electricity. So that's just a brief overview of what some of our research has found. I'm happy to talk a little bit more in depth about the benefits of clean energy as well as our findings on particular industries in the Q&A. So thank you.
Lynn, thank you very much. Chris?
Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank everyone for being out here today. This is a very special day for CPS Energy and for San Antonio. So again, thank you for being here. I'm going to echo a lot of the comments that Lynn made. Texas is absolutely a leader in clean energy. It's made significant investments in infrastructure. The CREZ lines, I think the state spent about $6.8 billion to be able to bring renewable resources, whether it be wind or solar, from West Texas, from the Panhandle, to load centers like San Antonio, Dallas, Houston, Austin. And so significant investments have been made. In fact, the state is expecting to have about 18,000 megawatts of renewables by 2020. And that's about a quarter of the state's generation capacity. So that's a big deal. In fact, even today, we're seeing days where, you know, half of the state, half of our city is powered by renewables, mostly wind at this time, but it will be solar here shortly with some of the things that we're doing. So renewables is a very real story here in Texas. As Lynn said, we have vast amounts of renewables, whether it be solar, wind, or other types of renewables. And so that positions us well to continue to be a leader here in the country. We have a very efficient market with ERCOT. It's an energy-only market. So if you build a plant, whether it be a solar plant or a wind farm, you can basically connect it to the grid and sell that power. It's truly a free market here. In fact, a lot of the most recent plants have been merchant plants where they're not requiring an off-taker. They're basically just selling it directly into the market as renewable prices have come down. So we have a very efficient market. Wonderful solar and wind resources here. We have the transmission capacity to get it to load centers, and then we have a very strong economy. So Texas is very well positioned to continue its leadership role in clean energy. And CPS Energy is really at the forefront of this. I mean, we have had 5 years of significant transformation. These are a couple charts. In 2011, we had 14 megawatts of solar. That was a record amount for Texas at the time. Now we are talking about in 2016 having 444 megawatts of solar. So, you know, we've significantly ramped that up. We're number one in Texas for the amount of wind that we have in our portfolio, the amount of solar. We've got the most significant demand response energy efficiency program. So we truly are a leader in Texas when it comes to clean energy. The other thing that makes it special, and that's kind of what ties in today, is, and this is under the leadership of our CEO, Doyle Beneby, is really to create a new energy economy around this this ecosystem. And so we are looking at having 1,000 plus jobs here by 2016 to basically support these activities. And we're already well over 700 jobs with our partners. So these are San Antonio citizens that are basically employed in these industries and are part of this vision and executing this vision. So we believe new energy economy impact will reach $1.6 billion by 2018. So those are some big numbers. This is a picture of all of our partners. This picture was blank 5 years ago. So you can see over 5 years, we've had a significant amount of investments in capital and employees around clean energy here in San Antonio. And some of these partners will be talking here today. And then finally, just to wrap it up, we've received national accolades for what we're doing here, whether it be kind of from the EPA administrator, whether it be our CEO, Doyle Beneby, receiving the CEO of the Year award from SEPA, the Solar Energy Power Organization. CPS ranked number 7 in the country from the amount of solar deployed. So we're starting to get that national recognition for some of the great things we're doing here in Texas and in San Antonio. With that, I'll turn it over to Andrew.
Terrific, Chris. Thanks very much.
Actually, I don't need this. The first invitation came from CPS Energy like 2 weeks ago that participate in this panel and didn't expect to have some presentation and 5 minute talk. I just thought that I'd sit down and receive a question and answer. Yesterday, I had a time to bring some presentation up to the screen, but decided not to do, to just focus on me, my face. So,
good choice.
Thank you very much for inviting OCI as a panel. And personally, I'm very honored to be in this panel to start this event today. It was since 2006 that OCI started to be in this industry. We are like 50 years old chemical company located in Korea. We happen to produce the polysilicon. It's also the chemical material that used for the solar panel. Is a key material to generate the power from the sunlight. And our company in Korea decided like what we could do with this polysilicon. Can we expand our business kind of area from chemical to like clean energy? And there was a solution out there that we could do either panel manufacturing, cell manufacturing, doing a development, or being an investor to the renewable energy projects out there. Finally, we decided to be a developer in the United States because the United States was the booming up industry, the region in 2011. But we started very small in the east of the Mississippi. We didn't expect that we are going to be a large player in this area in the United States within 1 or 2 years. But thanks for CPS Energy. CPS Energy issued RFP with the concept that we really liked. It was not only a PPA, the power purchase agreement, but it offered like, let's grow together in one area, like building a hub of the energy, the renewable energy. And that aligned with our own strategy. So it was not easy negotiation, like 8 months of negotiation to sign the contract. But I believe those 8 months of time was very valuable to create the common interest of one contract. It's contract, there's two sides of the contract, but usually there's one wins, one loses, but this contract wins both. So OCI is very, very much kind of happy to establish our footprint in San Antonio in Texas. And we are about to grow from San Antonio to the world. So we are not only a developer in San Antonio, but we have our partners who can manufacture inverters, who can manufacture trackers, who could build a power plant like a construction firm in San Antonio. And also we have a panel manufacturers in San Antonio as well. So we have all sort of key equipment in San Antonio that we could bring to the other regions to be more competitive. Now I'm back in Korea. S.A. Shun is the CEO of OCI Solar Power right now, focusing on the North and South Central America here. OCI will use this initiative in San Antonio to expand our business globally. As Evan mentioned, that we're trying to be in China, Africa, India, Southeast Asia, to do a similar kind of strategy structure that we have done in San Antonio. So OCI is very happy to partner with CPS Energy and hope that we could expand our partnership furthermore, not only for the solar development side, but also the energy solution side. The next step, I think there should be some question about what would be the next area of the renewable energy, but there will be there's a bunch of the new technology out there, but OCI believe solar renewable energy plus the energy storage system will be the trend next 5 years. So I'll stop here. If you have any questions, maybe we have some time for the Q&A.
We'll definitely have some time for questions from the audience.
Thank you very much,
Andrew,
for inviting.
Thank you very much.
OCI.
So let me ask our panelists some questions to get us started here. All interesting, and in many ways you've answered a lot of questions I had, but you've raised others, beginning with this idea that somehow Austin and San Antonio disproportionately represent the renewable market in the state of Texas. It's a very big state, growing very quickly. And for Austin and San Antonio, that's great, but it's pretty terrible for the rest of the state that they're so late to the party here. Why Austin and San Antonio? What are the conditions particular? Chris, let me start with you. What are the conditions particular to those two markets, or to San Antonio specifically, since we're in San Antonio today, that separate them from other parts of the state?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think part of it is we have a longer-term view on how do we serve this community. I mean, In the IOU world, you may have kind of a shorter term view. You've got sort of quarterly earnings that you got to think about. We really have a long-term view. We can make the right investments to position us very well over the long term.
Right.
I think the other thing about San Antonio is we've got the right leadership in place, both at the utility as well as at the city, at the county, to make this stuff happen. So we can not only put this vision in place, but we can actually execute on it.
Lynn, Chris is right. Leadership matters, and the corporate environment, the investment mindset matters. But at the end of the day, if the community doesn't buy in, none of that stuff matters. Right. What is it about the San Antonio community and the Austin community, similar in some ways, different in very specific ways, that makes those communities so receptive to moving over to the renewable space?
Well, I think having long-term market signals is very important in attracting investment. And so one of the factors I mentioned was that you do have this 20% by 2020 renewable goal here in San Antonio. That sends a signal that this is a place that wants to do business in clean energy. And this CPS also offered a variety of rebates to encourage consumer adoption of clean energy, entered into these power purchase agreements with OCI Solar. So I think that long-term vision that Chris was just speaking about, it sends a signal that, okay, OCI Solar, other developers, this is the place to do business.
Right. And Andrew, I want to ask you a version of that question, but from a different side of it. So what about Texas or what about San Antonio makes this an appropriate or attractive market from OCI's perspective? There are a lot of places you could go, a lot of places you could do business.
Right.
But why here? What about this market?
So very, very good question. When we first decided to move into San Antonio, Texas, there was a kind of risk that we have to take, because there's a perception that Texas is not friendly for the renewable energy. Right. And there was not many solar power development in Texas compared to California or New Jersey at that time. But CPS Energy has a different vision. And I believe CPS Energy has a different vision with all other utilities in Texas. So let me talk about two things very short. One is CPS Energy's leadership and their vision. They're investing into this renewable energy. So developers like us is looking for a project that could make a money for us, right? And there was a risk, there was a return, but OCI believes that not only the one-time investment, building a plan and just walk away, we want to use this as a stepping stone to do more business in Texas. And we saw the opportunities in Texas because it's different from California. There was not many competitions here. Grid lines was clean and very nice compared to the other states because there was a wind, but not many solar power development
right.
in Texas. So there are two aspects. One was the environment of the industry was good, not harsh competition in here, very good infrastructure. Second was CPS Energy's leadership. So,
but you make a great point that I need to push down the path a little bit, and that is Texas's reputation. You know, this is an oil and gas state. We still produce the most crude oil
right.
of any state in the country. Mm-hmm. And our economic health over the last couple of years relative to other states' economic health has been largely as a result of the strength of the energy sector, by which I really mean oil and gas. I don't really mean renewables. So mm-hmm. coming here to do this kind of work is in some ways pushing against the conventional stereotype or narrative of Texas, right?
Well, I think the flip side of that, Evan, is you know Texas is also a market-driven state. So if it makes business sense, they're going to do it. And so I think the way we've approached renewables is a little bit different. We've run the economics over a longer period of time, not just you
right.
know, what does it pay back this year or 2 years. And so if you take that longer-term view, I mean, it is market-driven, our decisions to kind of move into this space.
Yeah.
And I think Texas is starting to see that. We're starting to see merchant plants getting stood up in Texas.
Right. But the economic footprint that you talked about, the amount of money you're talking about in attracting an investment, the business you're going to do, and the jobs you've created are relatively small compared to what the oil and gas industry has produced over the last couple of years. How do you gross that up to a point that you get the attention of people and make them believe that renewables are really going to be a major contributor to the economy of the state? What do you do about that, Chris?
Well, we've got 1,000 employees here.
Right. I mean, I know you've got to start somewhere.
You've got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
But I think I think both can coexist. Oil and gas as well as renewables can coexist. Oil is primarily a transportation fuel versus a utility power fuel.
Right.
You know, gas obviously has overlap on both. But I certainly think both can coexist. And I think Texas is very much getting on board with renewables.
And it seems to me, based on the downturn in the oil and gas economy that we've seen
right.
over the last few months, events that we don't control are much more likely to impact the degree to which oil and gas does well or does poorly by Texas.
Exactly.
Renewables may not be as susceptible to that.
Right.
Right. I was interested, Lynn, to see you put up the slide about state policy. Of course, I lived my entire life, these 140 days of a Texas legislative session, thinking about state policy, mm-hmm. the degree to which it impacts in a favorable way and often in an unfavorable mm-hmm. way life out here in the state. The conditions that come from the capital in Austin, the stuff that you cited, does matter, right?
Mm-hmm.
It is, from a business perspective, an attractive set of attributes.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about that compared
yes.
to other places?
Well, I, as I mentioned, I think it's really what kind of long-term signal are you sending to the markets? And so what we found in the 8 states we examined, they were, you know, very diverse in this particular sets of policies that they had in place. Like, for example,
right.
we looked at Georgia, which doesn't have a renewable portfolio standard, but it has this goal that it adopted in 2013 of deploying 525 megawatts of solar by 2016. We looked at North Carolina, which has had a renewable portfolio standards in place since 2007. Those kinds of concrete, predictable, long-term goals, that sends a signal to the market that, okay, there's some certainty here. This is going to drive, you know, interest and investment in this field. And so having predictable, stable policies in place, we found that, you know, across the states we looked at, that was a common ingredient that was very important in attracting
right.
investment.
So this was Rick Perry's mantra for all those years: low taxes, predictable regulation,
right.
tort reform, which
mm-hmm.
may not be quite as much of a factor in the renewable industry mm-hmm. as it is in others. But certainly low taxes and predictable regulation is mm-hmm. probably something that
right.
is useful. And here we are coming out of a legislative session in which business taxes are going to be cut significantly. That can't hurt.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of a business climate, probably for investment in the state. Andrew, what is federal, so state policy matters, obviously, in terms mm-hmm. of attracting this business. Does federal policy matter? Talk about federal policy, U.S. federal policy, as it relates to this. How is the U.S. government and its approach to this stuff helpful or not helpful in the space in which you occupy?
It was helpful for that investment tax credit, 30%, which we expect to expire end of 2016.
Right, that's a somewhat controversial issue itself, right?
Right?
Yeah.
But it's a supply and demand market, and it's a return and risk market. That we have, this is capital intensive projects, This building a power plant is very much capital intensive.
Right.
So we have to find the right investors to partner with. And they are all like looking into the return figures. And we are not just competing by state, but or utility by utility, but we are competing with globally. Like for example, India.
Right.
When you go to India, the project we could build is less than $1 per watt. Return is 17%. But there is a country risk and currency risk out there.
Right.
So we have to, the investment tax credit 30% is very, very important. But it's not only that federal incentive, but we have to look over all globally how we can compete with the other countries.
Right.
And I think I mentioned about the energy storage system that could help to be more competitive market. U.S. could be a more competitive market if the federal or state government could support to install the energy storage system.
So that is one thing that the federal government could do that they're not doing now, but that would be that would help business.
Mm-hmm.
To what degree are incentives offered by places you might seek to do business important to you? Here in the state of Texas, we've had many, many years of offering business incentives, mm-hmm. and it's actually become kind of controversial. It's turned around on us because we've discovered that a lot of the people to whom we gave incentives to locate their businesses here didn't create the jobs they promised that they would create. It's just become kind of a hot potato politically. How important are incentives to the kind of work that you do?
Yes, it is very important. Like region by region, there's a different taxes. And our power plant has to pay taxes, property tax, for example,
right.
in Texas. Other taxes are very favorable in Texas, but the property tax is very high. And we're using a large size of the property.
Right.
It's like 900 acres, 1,000 acres of the land. So, but the school district are very favorable to build the renewable energy. So they're giving us a lot of incentive and favors.
Right.
That helps a lot. So I think those kind of incentives, like regional incentives, state incentives,
it does matter. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, another hot potato politically has been eminent domain and property rights and mm-hmm. the question of whether people in communities may want to resist Crestlines, or they may want to mm-hmm. resist some of the stuff that would be necessary infrastructure for renewable energy. Can you talk a little bit about that? You may have had experience here, but you've also worked in Houston. You understand right. across the state this is a thorny issue sometimes.
Yeah, it is a thorny issue, but I would say that the good news is the CREZ line is pretty much in place, so a lot of those issues
right.
are behind us. And for the most part, you know, we've seen very little resistance, a lot of enthusiasm for, you know, siting a community solar project or a solar farm next to a school or even a wind farm. So I think, you know, the eminent domain issue is less of an issue in terms of siting those facilities because there's a lot of positive feelings about having renewable resources as part of our mix.
Great. So Andrew did a good thing as we wrap up this portion of it and go to the audience. He sort of cited something that, you know, in a perfect world he'd like to see happen mm-hmm. that would make it easier for business to be done and for this renewable energy world to expand beyond what it is right now. Chris, at the federal level or the state level, what's something that you would like to see happen, either a hurdle eliminated or something that is not in place now that you'd like to see be in place?
That's a tough question. In my view, I think we've passed that tipping point where the renewable market is more policy-driven versus market-driven. I think we're moving to more of a market-driven system here with renewables. I mean, I think we still need support like the ITC tax credit. If we could, instead of having it go away immediately, maybe it can be ramped down over some period of time to give some transition, some certainty to projects that are still in the works.
Yep. Okay. And Lynn, same for you. Either at the federal level or the state level, what hurdle would you like to see taken mm-hmm. down, or what opportunity that we're not leveraging can we be leveraging?
I would definitely echo what Chris said. I think, you know, we are getting close to cost competitiveness on a lot of clean energy technologies, but I do think that having a little bit longer term certainty with some of these incentives will really accelerate that and allow that to happen more quickly. And so, you know, way Congress has in the past renewed the production tax credit retroactively at the end of the session, you know, for 1 year, it doesn't really provide a lot of certainty for investors to plan. If we could have, you know, a few more years, multi-year extension, potentially with ramp down, that would be helpful. I think the same thing with the ITC if it didn't go off a cliff in 2016. And then one thing I mentioned earlier, these technologies that improve efficiency like cogeneration and waste heat to power, we've been advocating that they get more parity in the tax code as well. Right now, cogeneration only gets 10% tax credit as opposed to 30% for solar. Waste heat to power is not included. And these are really no-brainers for Texas because you do have so much industrial energy use. Saves money, reduces energy consumption, you know, helps with demand response, and it also can provide a resilient source of on-site power that's independent from the grid. So if there's a disruption to the power grid, you know, a university or a manufacturing facility or a hospital can stay up and running. So, you know, I think that that could be further improved as well. So I do think on the incentive side, there could be a lot more certainty.
A lot of work to be done. Yes. All right, so we've got a few minutes now to do questions. Paul, you'll keep an eye on the time and give me a Heidi when it's time to wrap up. But let me ask for questions. We're not going to have you amplify. Just use your outside voice, and we'll repeat the question if we have to. Sir? It's a great question. There's disruption in every industry, and technology is going to save us. We're told that over and over. And so,
well, I think the big one for us, and Andrew mentioned, is energy storage. I mean, that could be a true game changer for renewables. Allows us to kind of firm up those resources, and you know, some of the breakthroughs and innovation that they're having on that front are pretty exciting. And so, that could be a very positive game changer for the utility business. We're also trying to be very active in more distributed renewable markets, you know, rooftop solar, those type of markets, electric vehicles, and how they might charge back into the grid, into the network. And so we're trying to figure out what is our model so that we can really add value to our customers with that.
You know, Lynn, this is a DIY world, right? Everybody in their own individual space wants to control what they do and how they do it. Are there disruptions in the realm of how consumers interact with utilities?
Oh, yes.
That might be on the horizon, that might be a part of this conversation.
Absolutely. I think a lot of utilities around the nation are struggling with the challenge and opportunity of distributed generation. In some ways, it's really a threat to the existing revenue models for a lot of utilities, which is the more power you sell, the more money you make. And so I think more progressive utilities like CPS are saying, this is coming. Consumers want this. We need to embrace this head on and figure out a way to integrate in that, our system, and increasingly looking at ways of offering services that are, you know, kind of decoupled from just the power sales. We're actually going to be later this year releasing a report that is looking at this issue of, you know, what does distributed generation mean and what are some of the barriers to it, and looking at this utility question.
Andrew, you know, one of the, I think, fair knocks on this country is that we think we know everything. So help me understand from the standpoint of disruptive technologies and innovations, what's happening outside of the United States that we may see inside the United States over the next couple of years that may ultimately change this conversation?
Yeah, it's related to the storage, but there is not only a distributed generation market, but there is also the microgrid market, which also exists in the United States as well.
Okay.
Like military bases, they use their own powers. So lots of islands in Southeast Asia, they have to all have their own power generation they have to consume by themselves. Lots of them are using diesel generators, which is very expensive. So the technology that many companies are trying to develop is to make a universal system that could combine with the inverter, PV, diesel generators, other source of the power that control over a microgrid, like a remote area, the enclosed loop in the one region. And if we can do that, if we can find a right solution at the right cost, it will be market changers that many of the developing countries need this technology.
But of course, you've hit on the thing. It's expensive to do it, right?
It is expensive right now, but there is lots of companies, technology companies, to drive down the cost.
That might be the disruption, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Other questions for our great panelists? Ma'am.
Tell me a little bit about what you think about the feasibility about that and what that might mean for the citizens of San Antonio.
It's a great question. The city of Georgetown, just north of Austin, has announced plans to go to 100% renewable. I think even in Austin, which tends to think of itself as a very progressive city, a bunch of eyebrows raised at that.
Right, yeah. Well, and Georgetown's a little bit smaller, and you know, there are ways of going 100% renewables and kind of still rely on the, you know, the broader ERCOT market. You know, I think until we address this intermittency issue, while you can, you know, maybe get there from a goal standpoint, you still, from a physical delivery of that power, there's still some challenges that have to be worked out. Energy storage is kind of one of those things that has to be worked out. But we are continuing to look to raise the bar for CPS Energy and San Antonio. So we are going to meet our 2020 goals in 2016 with the big OCI deal. And so we are looking at potentially raising the bar for how much renewables we've got here in San Antonio and CPS.
Of course, Georgetown, as you point out, is a small community.
Right.
San Antonio is second largest city in the state, seventh right. largest in the country. Austin is growing, we know, by leaps and bounds right. very quickly. Interesting that Houston and Dallas are not part of this conversation. You were formerly the sustainability director under Mayor Bill White in Houston. You know Houston well, probably know Dallas a little bit less well. Where are Houston and Dallas in this conversation?
Well, I think they're coming. You know, I think, like you said earlier,
I think you're being nice.
Yeah, I still have some ties and loyalty to Houston.
It's okay. Just tell us.
I think, again, the thing that makes unique San Antonio and Austin somewhat unique is that longer-term view, that leadership, that cohesive leadership. Houston, Dallas, you know, those are mega cities. Those are, you know, very much business-driven. And so, you know, they're going to be looking out for the bottom line. But the good news in all this is, you know, I think to Lynn's point, you know, the renewables, clean energy is becoming the bottom line. So I fully expect those cities to move pretty fast. And when they move, they move fast.
It'll be in their economic interest to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. So,
other questions? Sir. Right.
Inexpensive energy is seen as polluting. So how can you all help us to shape that conversation to speak to?
Well, how do you hit the strip in the center of those? On the, you know, cheaper but dirtier is at least the theory. But for a lot of people, Lynn or Andrew, this is true. The from a consumer's perspective, this is kind of a boutique-y thing. And the cost curve has not bent down in their direction yet. Or at least that's the perception. Andrew, what do you do about that?
So you have to look into German market, Japan market, Hawaii, California, to how they implement a lot of solar power generation on top of the household. So for example, Hawaii, they like more than 20% of house. So 2 out of 10 houses has the
right.
renewable energy. Still, it's very expensive. I don't have any clear answer right now, but there's a lot of studies out there how we can build more like small size residential rooftops so that at the competitive cost for sure to make it like feasible for
right.
for the homeowners.
Lynn, you understand that even if the reality is that the inexpensive energy is not as polluting as they think or as people say, and if it's true that the renewable portfolio is not as expensive for consumers,
right.
perception is everything, right? How do you change the perception?
I think the vast majority of people that are installing clean energy systems on their homes are not necessarily doing it for environmental benefits at all. They actually are for cost-saving benefits, and I think one of the game changers we've seen in this country has been the advent of the lease model, because you can install a solar system now in some places with zero down, and you're actually, you know, repaying the cost over time, but you actually see savings in the long run.
Well, you yes. see savings quicker than...
Exactly, right. than if you're owning it, and so I think that has been a real game changer in making these systems affordable, but I do think that the municipal utilities or, you know, state or local governments and the federal government do play a role in thinking about, okay, well, what does this community need and helping consumers get there? Because, you know, over the long run, clean energy will be cheaper than the ups and downs of, you know, commodities like natural gas. Over the long run, we do see this as inevitable. So if you do have policies and incentives in place to help make these things affordable for consumers, that drives the market. They say, I can get this tax credit or this rebate.
Right.
Okay, yeah, I like the idea of generating my own power on site. I like being independent of my utility. You know, these are attractive things to customers.
Chris, you want to get in on this?
Yeah. Affordability is very, very important to us. I mean, whenever we look at any potential deal or investment, we look at, you know, what's the impact to the customer bill. And so that is very key to us. We've got, you know, some of the lowest rates among the top 20 cities in the country at 10 cents a kilowatt hour. So, you know, that is a big part of our equation. The other thing I'd say on that, Evan, is that perception is changing. So, you know, with younger generations coming in play, it's an expectation to have clean energy. It's not, I'm going to pay a premium. It's an expectation.
Got it. That's it. All right, Paul's telling me we're out of time. Great conversation with our panelists. Please thank Lynn, Andrew, and Chris. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Hello. There we are. All right, everyone. Thank you very much. Evan, Andrew, Chris, and Lynn, thank you very much. Great conversation. Chris mentioned, you know, our partnerships with the community and how far we've come because of our close ties to the community. So we'd be very remiss if we didn't recognize a few folks who are here today. From the Greater San Antonio Chamber of Commerce, Mr. Richard Perez is here. We also have Al Ariola, South San Antonio Chamber of Commerce, is here as well. Gabe Farias, West San Antonio Chamber of Commerce, is here as well. And then last but certainly not least, Mr. Mario Hernandez from the San Antonio Economic Development Foundation. I want to thank you for being here today. All right, thank you, sir. Well, thank you very much. We're going to take a short 10-minute break, and we'll be back for our second panel and our unveiling. So thank you. All right, so welcome back. Our second panel is just about ready to start. You know, we talk quite a bit here at CPS Energy about being customer obsessed, which translates into ensuring that all interactions with our customers, whether they're online or in person, are positive and very impactful. And, you know, our customers leave feeling that they have their energy company is a trusted partner. And that's very important to us. So with us today are panelists that are at the forefront of innovative, customer-centric ideas. Moderating this panel is our very own Greg Sarich, Senior Vice President of Enterprise Support and Chief Information Officer here at CPS Energy. Greg oversees our corporate services support services functions, including supply chain procurement, vehicle fleet, and information technology. And prior to joining CPS Energy in 2013, Greg served as Vice President of Information Technology for TXU Energy in Irving, Texas. He also served in leadership positions at Hewlett-Packard and EDS. Greg, take it away.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. We're going to call this discussion Customers and the Utility Evolution. So the rise of the consumer is upon us. You may have heard terms called prosumers and consumerizations. And how has that all transpired over the last several years? Well, I will tell you, just over eight years ago, there was a little device that was introduced into the market. And this device has really changed industry, not only across the US and in the utility industry, but across the globe. And so this has served as a catalyst of information to our consumers. So as we talk about that, that is part of what our panel discussion is all about. And we've got three distinguished gentlemen who are very smart and have bios that are so long, I actually have to read them, so bear with me, but three very distinguished gentlemen. At first, David Helliwell, he's the Vice President of Utility Solutions for Enernoc. As Vice President of Utility Solutions, David is responsible for Enernoc's business with grid operators, utilities, and retailers. Prior to Enernoc, David was founder and CEO of Vancouver-based Pulse Energy until it was acquired in December of 2015. It's going to be acquired in December 2015. Thank you.
It was acquired last December.
Oh, okay. Got it. Sorry. My fault on that one. Before starting Pulse Energy in 2006, David was an exploration geophysicist for a Paris-based consultant and director of policy for a cabinet minister in the Canadian federal government. While with the Canadian government, David was responsible for reducing costs and improving environmental performance. David is an Action Canada Fellow, a member of the selection committee for the Canadian Merit Scholarship, a member of the BC Cleantech CEO Alliance, and is on the Imagine BC Advisory Board. Welcome, David. Raj Vaswani, he's the Chief Technology Officer for Silver Springs Network, one of our core partners. Raj has been with Silver Springs since 2003 and brings more than 15 years of innovation, product, and experience to internet, software, and networking industries into the company. Prior to Silver Springs, Raj was the entrepreneur in residence with Foundation Capital. Prior to Foundation Capital, he served as vice president of engineering for opinionsnot.com, now shopping.com, a consumer-oriented website. Raj was also senior scientist and director of engineering for At Home Network, later Excited Home, and he holds an MS in computer science from the University of Washington and a BS from the University of California at Berkeley. Welcome, Raj. Last, Jake Levine, director of strategy and chief of staff for Opower, again, one of our partners. As the director of chief of staff of Opower, Opower's mission is to give everyone the information and motivation they need to take control of their energy use. From 2009 to 2010, Levine served on the staff of the White House Office of Energy and Climate Change, where he worked on a host of innovative and energy policies. Jake also served as a member of President Obama's delegation to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change in Copenhagen, and on 2009, he served on the inaugural committee for President Obama. Opower's business development in emerging markets with a focus in China and Brazil is also part of Jake's responsibilities. Jake graduated cum laude from Harvard College and received his law degree from Harvard Law School and is now in technology. Interesting. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. So let's give a San Antonio welcome to our three panelists, and if you'll join me up on stage. I'm going to ask David to go ahead and step up and talk to us a little bit about what his role is at Enernoc.
Should I?
Yes, you should do that.
There we go. Thank you. So Andrew and I are using the same slide deck for this presentation. You may prefer to look at his face though if you want it. So my name is David Helliwell. I'm with Enernoc. I wanted to split this 5 minutes into a couple pieces. One, to tell you a little bit. Thank you. And then the second is how we see the importance of innovation, and particularly situations like this, of bringing together the people in this room and the organizations that we represent to really do something special. So Enernoc is a software company, energy intelligence for all the non-residential customers that utilities have, so from the smallest pizzeria or shoe shop to the largest industrial facility. Enernoc's largely known as a demand response company. We've got about 9,000 megawatts of load that we can be dispatched at any time for demand response. We're also very active with helping for energy intelligence for small commercial programs, so helping utility to segment their customer base. So down to about 120 different customer types to know which messages work with which customers at which times, whether you're sending a demand response signal, energy efficiency, these other programs might be interesting. Work with about 55 utilities in a dozen countries. Something, you know, sort of as a segue, that, you know, the importance of the innovation is the added complexity that's happening. Solar, as an example, some mentioning of storage, other distributed generation. From my perspective, the more complicated that whole system gets, the more fun things become, because one, things are changing quickly, so that means that we need to find new ways of dealing with it. And two, it's inherently complicated, so we need to come up with new ways of figuring out how to make things work together. We've just launched partnerships both with Tesla and with SunPower, for example, to decide when things turn on, when things turn off, when you send power to the batteries, when you pull it back. You know, every company is going to be finding their ways of making this happen. And here at CPS, I think it's really exciting to have such strong leadership to really make these things happen. In terms of the innovation, we have a mantra. So We now means Enernoc, as we were mentioning, that I sold my company, Pulse Energy. We had about 70 people to Enernoc in December, and the whole company was built on an idea of start fast and iterate. And to see a utility and, you know, a large utility like CPS taking that sort of approach to get something started faster than utilities usually do, I think, makes it extra exciting for companies like us and the other partners to really get involved here. And then in terms of the two elements of innovation that are important, external and internal, customers are expecting things that are different from their providers. So Greg, you're showing your cell phone. They expect things to be easy. They expect their utility interactions to be as simple as their bank interactions or their cell phone provider interactions or better. So all these things are changing pretty quickly. Something that's another interesting element on the innovation front is just the engagement of the team. And it's something that we've found has been a great way to attract and retain the smartest people, the best people you can find, is this combination of doing something that's meaningful on the one hand, but also challenging and pushing the frontiers. So you know, we've got dozens of data scientists, for example, who had been working with particle accelerators, working at NASA, all these things where you know they could spend 20 years and find something that was just a tiny, tiny bit ahead of what had been done before, that no one, you know, that certainly their mothers wouldn't be able to tell to their friends over dinner. But now you can come into this space where there's so much greenfield opportunity, and you can take that level of brain power and really, you know, in a year or two, really move the needle on something that's never been done before. And I think that's a really exciting opportunity that we have before us. So that should be about the 5 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So please welcome Raj Vaswani from Silver Springs Network.
Morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here. Let me tell you a couple of quick things about Silver Spring Network, since not everyone may be familiar with us, and then we'll talk a little bit about how it ties into what we're talking about today. So Silver Spring was founded about 12 years ago on a couple of ideas. The first was that at the time we were talking a lot about how we were going to transform energy, and that there was going to be this magic thing called the smart grid that was going to allow us to integrate renewables, to deal with the electric vehicles, to deal with our reliability issues, all of these kinds of things. And it sounded like a really interesting problem to solve, a planetary scale problem to solve, that if we didn't solve that problem, there wasn't going to be a planet. So it sounded very interesting, except, unfortunately, that we were not power engineers or electrical engineers or material scientists or physicists. We were networking and software people. So we sort of said, well, I wonder if there's going to be this thing called a smart grid with all these devices and applications talking to each other, whether anyone's building kind of the networking and software platform that makes that possible. So in the same way that in your home, your Wi-Fi network supports your printers and your TVs and your computers, is anyone building that kind of thing to allow all these devices and applications to speak to each other? And the answer back then was absolutely not, and that's what we set out to do. Our second observation was that if you built something like that, it was something that actually provided value outside of just energy, that what you were really doing was building a network across a geography, across all of San Antonio, for example. And so surely, once you had that network, you could actually connect some other things to it and increase the value of that infrastructure. And so what I think we really were talking about was that you'd start with something like smart grid and smart energy infrastructure and allow all these things to communicate and modernize that infrastructure, but that moves on very quickly to smart city, a generalized smart infrastructure, and what today people are calling kind of the Internet of Things and the Internet of Everything, right? So this idea of all these things going on. But very importantly, we don't build the devices. We don't build meters, we don't build switches and those kinds of things. And we also, for the most part, don't build the applications. We're neither smart nor distinguished enough to actually do that. What we do is we enable those things. And so what we find very interesting about Epicenter is a couple of things. This notion that what it's really about is bringing together the smartest people around, lots of great ideas, and incubating those and driving those forward, not just for energy, by the way, but also in this more generalized smart way, because what's happening now is a great deal of innovation around new kinds of devices and applications, and all of that can kind of live in this infrastructure. I think that's really the answer to a question asked on the earlier panel, which is, well, you know, Chris, how are you going to scale up your job creation? Well, it's because there are a few targets and a few things that we can see today that might create jobs or be interesting things. But what's very difficult to predict is what's going to come next, but it's probably going to be something. I guess I've been doing networking for a long time, and I think there's actually only one thing I know about networking. It's that I don't know how the network's going to be used. Basically, you know, that once you can hook up a red thing and a yellow thing, someone a lot smarter than me realizes that you can now build an orange thing, right? And so the point is that that's going to create a whole bunch of different sort of innovation that I think will expand what even the current targets are. And so that also sounds good, and I think many labs around the world have that kind of vision. So why this one? Well, that has everything to do with, I think, our respect and I think our alignment with CPS Energy's perspective on this. And I think there are a few key sort of aspects to that. The first, I think, is this intrinsic notion, and Chris talked about this at the beginning, this intrinsic notion about an ecosystem and the notion that you have to bring in, it does take a village, and it's not just sort of a simple vertical set of things that need to happen, but you try to bring in and bring together the smartest people around, and something good will happen. The second, I think, is a notion of sort of stewardship, a notion that what we're trying to do is to actually improve the lives of the community, to solve these problems in a sustainable way, et cetera. And I think the third really has to do with that notion of community. I think what we've noticed is that even the term consumers may not be quite right for the way CPS Energy thinks about this. I think it really is about community. And there's an inclusiveness and a sort of need to deliver, the notion of delivering those kinds of benefits that I think is very intrinsic, matches up very well with the way we think about things. And so we're very proud to be a part of this.
Thank you, Raj. Jake?
Thank you. So you don't have to look at my face because I brought a presentation.
Yeah.
Let me just start quickly.
Sorry.
First of all, thank you for inviting OPower. It's an honor to be here. I wanted to quickly poll the audience on a quick question before we began. Raise your hand if you checked your email in the last day. Okay, so that's basically everybody. What about Facebook? How about your bank statement? Have you guys checked finances recently? When was the last time that you checked your energy consumption? One hand, two hands. Well, that is pathetic because this is a room full of people who care about energy. We think about this kind of question, how do people interact with their energy consumption? And we think about it in the context of these sorts of transformations that the other panelists have raised, questions of technological change and disruption that are happening now. And we see an industry in the midst of huge transformation. The old normal was a couple of priorities for utilities, keeping the lights on and delivering an accurate bill. And that was basically it. The utilities wouldn't really hear from their clients if those two things were going well. One of our clients likes to say that he's in the toilet paper business, and we ask, well, what are you talking about? He said, well, electricity is like toilet paper. People only notice it when it's not there. The industry is changing, though, and in addition to keeping the lights on, in addition to delivering a bill, people are expecting better services, more enhanced information that actually adds value to their lives. And we see this sort of taking shape against the backdrop of declining demand for electricity in many parts of the United States, not the case so much internationally, increased competition from folks like the distributed generators, the solar cities, the sun runs of the world, and regulation that is increasingly requiring utilities to provide this type of information and services to their consumers. And what this all points to is a change that puts the focus on the consumer. But as we know, I think Raj hit on this a little bit, some of the expectations that are changing, that are driven not necessarily by the utility industry, but by other industries. You use Uber and all of a sudden you expect a frictionless experience, not just in your transportation, but in all the other services that you use. But as we just learned, nobody really is paying attention to their own energy consumption. So how do we change this? And OPower has developed a philosophy that we like to call moments that matter, where we've learned that people spend a very limited amount of time thinking about their energy consumption. And so if you want to increase their awareness, their interaction, their engagement, then it's important to identify what are the moments that people actually are paying attention and create better experiences during those moments. And I just wanted to show you one moment in particular. We've identified a number, but I think that here at CPS, we're excited to start thinking about some of the demand side management applications, in particular demand response, where we can engage consumers, everyday mass market, residential and business consumers, to help reduce peak load during the hottest days of the summer. So I'm going to show you a quick animation of a pilot that we are running now in four different utilities. This shows you the legacy-based, the hardware-based legacy demand response program in Baltimore. Those yellow switches represented air conditioning switches that the utility could turn off during a peak event. And the green represents all consumers connected by a smartphone, or email, or phone call. And what our program does is it sends people notifications over email, SMS, or phone, asking them to participate in a peak reduction event during the hottest days of the summer. And what you can see here is that with very broad engagement, we get very broad participation. And this red area represents the savings that we saw over the course of this peak event. And then importantly, the next day, we send a follow-up communication, which tells people, hey, thanks for participating. Here's how much you saved. And please stay on the lookout for another peak event this summer. This is a moment that people care about. They see it as an opportunity to save some money. They see it as an opportunity to engage in their utilities programs and with their community. And it's a moment that we can take advantage of as technology providers to help create a better experience. There are many more moments, and we're looking forward to participating with CPS in those. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Hold on to the mic. All right, we're going to open up and have a little discussion with the panelists. And I wanted to talk a little bit about the consumer experience in the sense of, you know, when I worked in the deregulated market, sales and marketing, and, you know, you're working for a customer's business every day. At CPS Energy, we have a defined market, but we are actually taking a much more progressive approach at how we work with our consumers. Most of the country still is in a traditional market where they don't have to basically fight for their customers every day. In your experience, and we'll start with Jake, you know, why is it important that, you know, utilities get in front of this now, as opposed to just, hey, we're just there to turn on the electricity. It's really not about the customer. Why is that important, especially since you all see, you know, a broader sense of customer base?
Sure. It's a great question, and I think CPS is a great example. Your experience at TXU informing some of the work that you're doing here, Greg, is really emblematic of the answer. But you know, utilities, in particular, IOUs and regulated monopolies that have been around really since the early days of the grid, they've had the luxury to enjoy a captive market. Traditionally, in the United States, you saw increasing demand for electricity, so an increasing demand for services. That demand financed capital expenditures by these utilities, which then allowed utilities to receive a higher rate of return on their investments. And also, really, the captive audience was comprised of somewhat of a homogeneous customer base, electricity consumers. Today, all of that is changing. We're seeing flat demand. In some places, we're seeing decreasing demand. We're seeing increased competition, not a maintained monopoly. Distributed generation, with Tesla's announcement of this home battery storage, is going to enhance the degree to which competition enters the market, even in monopoly environments. And we see a heterogeneous customer base that expects services from its utility. When you take American Airlines to Dallas or go on vacation, you get a text message from American if your flight is late. that's a helpful text message. You can stay at home a little bit longer, spend some time with your family. You don't have to rush to the airport. You don't get angry at the gate agent when you learn at the airport suddenly that your flight is delayed. Those kinds of services are totally ubiquitous now in the world in which we're living. And the utilities are catching up to the other industries, transportation, telecommunications, banking, that really paved the way for those types of services. And now utility customers are increasingly expecting those services as well.
So let me ask David to kind of comment, because when we talk about, you know, this consumerization, a lot of times we're just thinking about the residential consumer out there, but there is a whole other market out there, and that's the commercial side. So I'd like to get that perspective, because sometimes that gets left out in the conversation.
Sure, absolutely, and particularly the small medium business segment is referred to as the frozen middle, and just forgotten, even though it can be a third of revenues who are not residential or large industrial. Maybe to link that in to your original question about, you know, why even care about these customers if you're a monopolist? Mm-hmm. We see a bunch of different reasons why utility companies will take that approach. Some are more defensive and protecting themselves. Some of them are more offensive. On the defensive side, you never know whether regulators are going to end your monopoly. So you'd better be in a strong position with your customers. Meeting with executives in Portugal, where they had to win back every single one of their customers, and so all of a sudden overnight they had half of their customer base gone, and they were pretty happy with that. Same thing could be happening in France for the commercial customers with Electricité de France. So you never know, state by state too, there could be another wave of that coming. So you better keep your customers happy. Another thing is just running your business better. So British Gas, a very competitive utility, one of the big six, the biggest of the big six in the UK. So they use our platform for all their business customers. And what we find is that the lessons learned there, because they need to do these things or they'll lose their customers, are very applicable to regulated monopolist utilities, just for understanding, okay, we want to promote this program to these customers. How do we know the right time? How do we know the right message? How do we know anything about this customer beyond their rate class and their customer number? These are things that are just needed for running a business, and are extra important for the commercial segment, where everybody's so different. Comparing a small restaurant in a shopping mall to a large standalone restaurant is arguably a bigger difference than you'll find between any two households. And that's just restaurants. So there are so many different variables to account for, just to run your business better and know your customers better.
Raj, I wanted to ask you, as Silver Springs, as being one of our core partners, you are an enabler for our overall network as we get data from our consumers from the meters. What's your experience, and what are you seeing both in the industry and then what we're doing at CPS Energy? Why is that such a key component for us as we think about consumer and consumer data and creating this kind of customer-obsessed focus, not only at CPS, but across the industry?
Right. So I think in the end, right, the data is what is producing the value of the thing. So the device's job is to perhaps provide some control, but mostly there are lots of these things that are producing the data, and how that data is used is what's going to characterize the value extracted. There's something called Metcalfe's Law, which basically says that the value of a network is the square of the devices that are attached to it. So if you have n devices attached to the network, the value of the network is n squared, because each of these devices can talk to each other in various ways that can produce data and so on. So what's happening with the data is what's creating the value. I think that's a little bit related to your earlier question, though, about kind of why now and why should we care about the way consumers view us. And I think the reason is that right now, I think, is actually a time of both unprecedented threat and unprecedented opportunity for the industry. The threat, of course, is what everyone has talked about, which is a threat of disintermediation via distributed energy resources provided by somebody else, et cetera. But the best weapon against disintermediation is almost always sort of either incumbency and having that existing customer relationship that one can improve and therefore keep hold on to the customer, and scale, which utilities already have. But what those two things also give you is the opportunity then to say, if I do establish this new relationship with the customer or the community, what other services can I now provide them in a world where they're expecting more and more of their services to be networked and analyzed using data and so on. So if I can provide them energy services, but I can also allow them to let me know that their local street light is broken in an easy way, does that help? If I can help them basically handle waste management, does that help? So I think unprecedented threat, unprecedented opportunity, but in the end, all of that gets done by using the data that's produced.
So I want to kind of, the underlying theme that I keep hearing here is about data, and I think everybody probably has heard, whether reading or watching the news, big data. It's a term, maybe even has term fatigue at this point, but it really means something, you know, to the consumer. I guess, Jake, I'll start with you in the sense of, you know, O-Power obviously has, you know, a lot of data, but you know, as you're working with CPS Energy, how do you think those data analytics and data analytics as a whole is going to impact the consumer? And do they realize it yet?
Sure. So we do have a lot of data. Our platform is now managing somewhere on the equivalent of about half of the U.S. Energy consumption data. It's the largest data set of its kind in the world. Last year, we managed about 400 billion different meter readings. That's a lot of data, and it is at times overwhelming. I think that one of the most interesting implications or applications of this data that we've discovered to date is around pattern recognition and around what we call sort of archetyping of energy consumption users. So a smart meter measures data at frequent intervals during the day. Traditional meters might give you a reading. Someone would go read the meter once every month to figure out how much energy you've used. I'm starting to smile because some of our clients in Europe actually read their meters on the order of once a year. In the US, once a month is considered infrequent. Now we have meters which send us data every 15 minutes. So that's a 3,000 times X increase in the amount of data that we're generating from these meters. And what we have learned is that people use energy differently over the course of a day. So you may have somebody who gets up early in the morning, makes breakfast, does some household chores, and their energy usage spikes in the morning. They go to work, they come home late, they don't really use that much energy during the rest of the day. There are other folks who do the exact opposite. They sleep in, they hang out at home for a little bit longer, maybe they come back in the afternoon, they run the laundry, and their energy usage spikes in the afternoon. Well, do you want to tell the person whose energy spikes in the morning to please turn off their air conditioning in the afternoon during a peak event, because that will help the utility to reduce its peak demand? Not really. That would be totally irrelevant. It'd be a wasted message. And only now are we beginning to understand who these consumers are, how they actually consume energy, and as a result, how should we be communicating with them? I think that increasingly, the consumers at CPS are aware of this. We're very proud to now be running a high bill alert program here, which allows users to understand whether they're on track for a high bill, which is something that is only, it's increasingly possible with the granularity of data that we're generating through smart meters. It's something that you can do in a non-AMI world as well. But soon, even in Brazil, as Raj and I were talking about, everybody will have a smart meter and will be able to deliver these kinds of communications much more frequently and to much greater effect.
I'll just open this up to the general panel. One last question, then we'll let some questions come in. you know, basically Chris showed, you know, all of all the partners that we're working with, and a lot of the technologies that are coming in are very, you know, disruptive to our model. The traditional utility model is definitely changing. It's no longer we're just selling kilowatt hours, we're also selling energy information services. You know, a lot of utilities, as I see, as I look across the industry, are fighting that, and it's been our position to not fight it. Let's look at it, let's embrace it, let's partner with folks. You know, talk to us about that CPS experience that you're having, and why that's so important, you think, as we go forward in the future. And let Raj, why don't you start off?
Sure. Yeah, I think it's the same real general observation I made earlier, which is that, you know, fighting these things is usually not going to work, right? What I think one has to do is to figure out how am I going to use the strengths I do have and adapt. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what CPS Energy is doing in spades, is basically saying, as I said before, starting with the notion of kind of community and stewardship, and this is our job, this is what we do, we're part of this community, and we need to work in it. But that, again, the way that's going to happen is by bringing in the smartest people we can find to try to figure out what are those innovations that we can actually use and leverage rather than spend all our time arguing against. It's a little bit like in the technical world where, you know, when you start a new thing, people basically talk, have a lot of arguments about standards and interoperability. And everyone sort of says, no, you know, I've got my wonderful mousetrap over here and it's built in this particular way and that's the one you should buy. Well, that's always a losing game. It's like when networks start, people always say, oh, it doesn't need to be IP and those kinds of things. But inevitably, those things win. And so again, I think in the same way, taking the approach, a sort of, you know, head in the sand approach is likely to fail. Whereas I think this inclusive and more sort of innovative approach not only sort of improves sort of the notion of survival, but actually is leading, right? And as I said, opens up these additional opportunities longer term that that can be prosecuted.
David, your thoughts?
Sure. Yeah, I absolutely. Just to build on Raj's point about going with your strengths, we've done a lot of customer surveys about what business customers expect of their utility and who they want to turn to as their trusted energy advisor. And hands down, it's always the utility is the first one they want to turn to get advice. So it's this opportunity there, this soccer ball rolling slowly in front of the net to be taken advantage of. If you capitalize on it, there's a real opportunity there. If you don't, it'll go and someone else will take that role. You know, I think it's a little like you know, the old story of the diggers when the old ones with cables and then the hydraulic ones coming in to replace them. You know, the companies that thrive in that say we're not a cable powered digger company. We're a digger company, and we'll move to the hydraulics to work. The ones who didn't just went out of business. So I think really the utility companies need to be everything to do with energy. You know, getting energy, managing energy. That's where they can really, really excel, and I think CPS is on the right track now.
Okay, thank you. Like that, we've got about 5 minutes. I'd like to give the opportunity. You can hold on to that to anyone in the audience who might have some questions that they may want to ask the panel. Yes, sir.
With all this new data going back and forth between all of us, what are we doing to make sure that data is protected?
Okay, I'm holding the mic. I'll just be quick about it. So as a software as a service company on the cloud, you know, Opower, same deal, and a lot of Silver Springs. It's just not something you can screw up with. So our approach has been to hire people who've done it already for the banking industry and following those levels of security and those standards, which are very high, obviously. And just overbuild it from a security perspective. One thing that I think people get more tied up in knots about than they need to is what's actually done with the data and how much analysis can be done with the data before sending it back to customers. On the business side, we've never had any pushback. We've got millions of businesses in the system from having done some value-added analysis and send some advice back to a customer. But that is something that gets brought up as a privacy concern. That's probably another conversation. Not sure if that's what you meant. But.
Well, I'll just add, just from a CPS Energy perspective, consumer information, consumer data is paramount, and that privacy of that information is key. And so to ever have that compromise would obviously not be in our best interest. We spend a lot of time focused on, security, cybersecurity, that term being used, to focus on how do we make sure we secure that data at all times. Every day there's a bad guy, if you will, always trying to not only CPS, but all companies trying to figure out how to get in, how to hack, how to do that. And so we're focused on that every day. We have processes, procedures, we have, programs and everything else that are focused on how do we protect that data and our assets across CPS Energy every day. And then the recent, addition of a former chief of San Antonio Police Chief McManus onto our staff to focus on security. Because remember, security not only of data and is also about assets, so it's physical as well. And so we look at that as a holistic picture. And Bill's got a good program that he's focused on. And we're working tightly with our fellow utilities. If there's one thing that the utilities are all working collectively across the U.S. and in the state as well, it's on cyber, because we all have to protect the assets, the grid, and so we're all sharing best practices wherever we can, because and whenever something new comes along, it's not about plagiarism, it's about how do we implement that new best practice, because it's going to help us. Other questions? Rudy?
Just the questions for Jake.
Yep.
Given all the data you all have analyzed, I think it was you who had done the raise your hands, what's the single thing that utility companies can do to move a customer from passive usage to active usage? Is it an iPhone app? Is it a gizmo in the house? I mean, what have you all seen that's transitioning a customer from one to the other?
Sure. There's no silver bullet here, and one of the, I think, really important notions is that customers are busy. Everybody's got a life with important things going on, and energy consumption is just not the priority. The priority is getting your kids to school. It's, am I late on my mortgage payment? Is my data safe? Is my family safe? And so one of our sort of core philosophies is that we want to meet the consumers where they are. And that means being on every channel. It means delivering paper messages for people who aren't as technologically apt and constantly on their mobile device. But it means for the folks who are on their mobile devices or on their email to have a web app and email and mobile and really to be across every channel so that we can reach consumers wherever they are. And I think that focusing on these moments where people are already engaged, did they just move into their new home? Are they looking for an opportunity to think about how they can improve their energy consumption in their home? Is the weather changing because it's winter and it's getting colder? Was there an outage and the power went out? Now you're thinking about, okay, how do I get the power back on? These are very practical moments when people are already asking, how can I reach out to my energy provider, this trusted advisor that I believe in, that has been providing me with this service, and I'm now eager to speak with them. And the sort of the philosophy that we've developed is that during these moments, there's a real opportunity to turn that passive energy user into a real active energy user who can be an asset for CPS, who can be a demand side resource and not just a passive user.
Yep. Go ahead. I just so fully agree that you need to capitalize on the windows, but something that we've seen as some collateral benefit of even from the people who never become engaged, when we poll them afterwards in terms of would you like to continue receiving this or not, overwhelmingly they say, yes, I didn't actually show you any signs of being more engaged, but I'm really appreciative that you're doing it, and please don't stop. So there is that other pretty significant portion of the population that are in that zone.
Okay. Any one last question, and then we have to wrap it up. Yes, sir.
On the communication side, for clarity, how are you communicating with your clients? I mean, is it a phone call? You can't send them a letter because if you're going to ask them to reduce their energy use,
so let me jump in on that. I mean, you're talking about to a consumer when we have...
consumer and all the markets.
Well, basically, let's talk from the consumer side, both commercial and residential. Basically, we set up preferences, how the consumer wants to be dealt with. Some might want an email, some want a phone call, some would like a text. You know, so I think it's important for us as a trusted advisor to know exactly how that customer wants to be communicated with. So all those options are available as we work through that process with them on how we communicate with them, and when those triggering events, you know, occur, how they want to, you know, receive that information to then take action.
So as a client for CPS, I have to go in and register with CPS and tell you how to communicate with me?
Well, we do things through email, but we don't want to make the assumption that we know exactly how you want to be communicated, because what you might like an email, other people might want in a text message. So it's about understanding you. It's important as we understand data and behavior patterns, what's the best way? But the best way to know is to ask you, and so that's what we'll do first. So then we need to do a better job at asking you. So. Let's go ahead and finish up, Jake.
I would just add that you know, this is one of the areas where the power of data can really be helpful in understanding what do we think your preference might be, and then you know, traditionally the way that we run our programs, we do it on an opt out basis. So we'll work in partnership with CPS, and we'll determine a certain area of the territory to provide communications to. And we'll just provide those communications. If you don't like them, you can opt out. But if you want to tweak them and you say, oh, you know what, I got this report in the mail, and actually it'd be much more convenient for me to get something over email or over SMS, you can provide that feedback. And so the opt-out feature really allows people to engage in a way that's convenient to them.
All right, we need to wrap it up. I want to thank our panelists, Dave and Raj and Jake, for our discussion on consumers and utilities and how we manage energy and make it beneficial, mutually beneficial for our consumers. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
All right, I want to reiterate, thank you, Greg and Raj, David and Jake, for your insights today. This has been great conversations this morning, conversations that truly capture the spirit and direction that our new energy economy is taking us. Want to thank all of our panelists today for participating and for leading great discussions and also leading us to this moment. Here to introduce all of you to what is truly the next evolution of our new energy economy is our very own President and CEO, Mr. Doyle Beneby.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. This is really a great day, but before I start with my comments, I'd like to thank our panelists and all of our guests. This is really a special moment for us, and I'll talk a bit about sort of how we got here. As many of you know, we sort of dreamed up this new energy economy thing a while back, and all along it was designed to be a partnership, and it was designed to be something that was hand in hand with the trajectory of San Antonio and our community. And so I'm happy to announce in a second an unveiling of what this has become. It's really gone from a concept to a design, and fairly soon it'll become a reality. But before that, I want to personally thank our some of our partners. We have with us S.H. Yoon from OCI. We have with us Raj Raswani from Silver Spring Network. We also have with us Gina Garner from Landis & Gear. And they have been our really foundation sponsoring partners. But as I talked about this concept years ago, I really talked to Chairman Lee, who's the CEO of OCI, the entire company in Korea, Greg Beck, who's the vice chairman now. I talked quite a bit to Scott Lang, the Silver Spring Network CEO, and also Prasanna Venkatesan with Landis & Gear, and also Richard Mora. So they all couldn't be here today, but we've had a sort of a galaxy of people that have been with us along the way, our partners. But you know, this new energy economy sort of concept that I talk about, really the big concept is to transition San Antonio and our community to leveraging our push towards renewables and low carbon intense technologies, along with commerce and building our community. And that was a big part of all along. So, but the second part of it was to try to make a mark in education. And what I'm going to talk about in a second, our unveiling, is really the culmination of that effort. This epicenter, as we call it, will be unique in its focus on creating thought and action around the research and development of new and emerging technologies. And we built on the tradition of our public-private partnerships that we forged along this wonderful Mission Reach area, or the Mission Reach area where the epicenter will be. And we, again, are leveraging education and innovation. And so this will be a place where many people in our community can come and commiserate with our partners and look at technologies. We also have the concept of including a portion of this design. It will house part of a CPS Energy museum. So it's going to also be a place that attracts the legacy of CPS Energy. And we have Scott Smith with us here, who is representing the entire legacy of all of our CPS Energy employees. And so this is special to us for a whole lot of reasons. Not the least of which it ties generations of CPS Energy. And I don't like to miss a moment to say that what we have here and what I've inherited as a leader of this fine organization, I stand on the shoulders of many people before me, many great CPS employees and leaders who've been in this role, who built this company to what it is today. And that's allowed us to do things like we're going to talk about today. We have some of our Citizens Advisory Council members here. We have the entire, I think, galaxy of CPS interest here today, along with our founding sponsors and partners. So with that, I would like to invite some of our partners up here for the unveiling. I'd like to invite Councilwoman Gonzales, please. I'd like to invite Scott, Raj, Gina, S.H., if you'd all come up, and we'll have the unveiling. I don't know, is Judge Wolf here? Okay. Also, I don't want to miss the opportunity to talk about other new energy economy partners. I see Paul Duran here with Green Star. So we've had others who've been along with us in this journey. But what you're going to see in a second, again, is a sort of physical manifestation and concept of what this is going to be. So I don't know if I don't see any drummers in here, so there probably won't be a drum roll. But I'd like to right now unveil our brand new concept of an epicenter. And I think we have a picture of will show in a second of what this used to be. But this is our concept, and we worked on it with our partners, Lake Flato Architects. And this is the actual a sky view of the center itself. And as you can see, it leverages a lot of the original building of the power plant, the stack, with a beautiful view of the skyline in the background. But inside this building, and we'll see some, you can see on the screen there, an auditorium that allows our partners to brand. The bottom floor shows a concept of the CPS Energy Museum, and another view of a outside walkway. But this is what it is, and I couldn't be more delighted to have this in a wonderful district Thank you, Councilwoman, for being here. And we hope that it lends to the adds to the continued development of the Mission Reach area, and this becomes an anchor for education, innovation, and more commerce in that part of our great city. So, with that, I don't know if we're going to take some more pictures.
And Councilwoman Gonzales.
Too. Yep. And with that, we'll turn over to Councilwoman Gonzales for some words then.
Good morning, everyone. Really such an exciting moment for me. It's been years now that Doyle and John and Rudy came to my office to present this concept, and I was nearly moved to tears. Because for those of you who are familiar with our city and with our district, this beautiful institution is in District 5. And it is one of the anchors of this community for education. And it's something that I'm very proud of. I live just a few blocks from here, and I'm always happy to have Our Lady of the Lake host events like this one. And so when this concept was presented as an educational opportunity, as an opportunity for our community to engage in a brand new technology, and that this site in particular was selected as an innovation center that the whole country would have its eyes on, right in the middle of District 5, right in the middle of my neighborhood, and right in the middle of the neighborhood where so many people have lived and grown and have been anticipating projects like these. And I see Susan Powers here, who is our neighborhood association president for the Lone Star Neighborhood Association, who has been such an active member of the community for so many years. And so for her to have been able to be a part of this and give her input and give her support is really transformational for a community like ours. And this also has spurred then many other attractions to this area. So we had the Mission Reach that extended through here, a multi-million dollar project with Bexar County, the city, Sarah, all partners. And earlier in the week, there was an announcement for the Lone Star Rehab Project just across the river from here, housing multi-family that should be under construction here soon enough. Very close by here, we have a couple of other housing that are also transformational, old rehab buildings that had been vacant for years up here in the Lone Star area, Big Tex and the Blue Star Rehab that's all along this Mission Reach is really transformational for this neighborhood. And so I talk about it on a very personal level because this is our neighborhood, but what it actually means for the whole country is something that we can all be proud of, that I'm especially grateful to CPS Energy and to Doyle for his vision, to our partners, OCI Solar, Silver Springs Network, Landis Gear, and everyone who else made this epicenter possible. I have my sincere thank you, not just what it does for San Antonio and places us on the map as a center for innovation, something that we never thought we would be. And I think that San Antonio, for those of us who have lived here and worked here and spent our lives here, wanting for this to be the best city that it could be, are seeing that happen now, thanks to the commitment of our partners, thanks to the commitment of many of you all sitting here in this room who believed that it could happen and are now seeing the result of that. And it's just such an exciting time to be in San Antonio and especially to be in District 5. And just so happy to see everybody here. And I had a couple of thoughts as I was listening to the panel. Because I'm not an expert on data, but I do think I'm an expert on people and what the people really want to see when we bring projects like this to our district or our city. And so for those of you who noticed, this is a lower income area. Many of the houses here are more than 100 years old. I myself live just a few blocks away. And I know that in my 100-year-old house, my energy consumption is very high. And it's partly because the houses were not really designed for the kind of infrastructure that we're seeing now. And we know that CPS Energy is making an incredible effort to rehab some of our homes so that they can be more energy efficient. My bill in my little house, my modest home, can be over $250 a month. That's really significant for this community. It's an incredible burden to continue to pay those bills. And so CPS Energy can not only do these incredible transformative projects that bring in alternative energies, but they can also help our individual community for our own homes to be energy efficient. And they